When we use divs, it's often because we want to divide our page into different boxes, resize those boxes, and move them around. It takes a good eye for design to decide exactly how to lay out a page so it looks good, but right now, we're going to ignore the goal of making a page look good and just show you how to change stuff up. Let's resize the official info div. By default, a div takes up 100% of the available width. That's why you see the gray box going across the whole page. But maybe I only want it to take up 300 pixels. Well, I'll add another property to the CSS rule up here, width colon 300 pixels. That worked, but let's do something more interesting. Let's use percentage width and say that the div will always take up 70% of the available width. Now, the text is constrained to that smaller box, and the div has gotten taller. If we really want to, we can also constrain the height of the box. With the height property, height colon 180 pixels. Okay, something funny happened. The gray box resized to 180 pixels, but the text is overflowing outside of that gray box. Why'd that happen? That is because of a property we call overflow. The default value for overflow is visible, which means that the element resizes, but the content flows outside of it, which looks a bit silly. What other options do we have for overflow? Well, we could try hidden. That cuts the content off, trimming it at the border. That's not what we want though, because then our viewers won't be able to read all of our amazing official info. We could also try auto, which tells the browser to add scroll bars if the content overflows. Now I can scroll around inside the box to see the text. If we want, we can be even more specific and specify different overflow properties for each direction. For example, we want it to overflow with scroll bars in the Y direction, up and down. We'll just overflow Y auto. But then if we want to trim it in the X direction, we can say overflow X hidden. Okay. Be careful anytime you're using overflow because scroll bars can get really annoying for the user, especially scroll bars within scroll bars. Avoid those if you can. Now going back to width height, we can actually use width and height for all sorts of elements, like our images. Now that you know CSS, you can use the width height CSS properties instead of the width height attributes. Let's make this cat image a bit bigger by giving it an ID, cute cat, deleting the attribute, and going up to our style rule, and let's say cute cat, and width 120 pixels. Just like before with attributes, it's best to only specify the width or the height, and let the browser figure out the best value for the other dimension. Otherwise, we'll have a squashed kitty. Well, okay, that sounds kind of awesome, so let's just try that for a second. The height, 40 pixels, squashed kitty, yay! Okay, I got that urge out. I'll be a responsible web developer and delete it now. The more knowledge you have, the more responsibility you need to take on. Just because you can add scroll bars to everything and squash all the kitties, it doesn't mean that you should. Because you're usually making websites for other people to use, and what you think is hilarious might be what they find super hard to use. But if you make a few funny things here on Khan Academy, I won't mind.